In 1966, congressional hearings were held with Secretary of Defense Harold Brown and scientific advisor of Project Blue Book, Dr. J. Allen Hynek.
What is the Air Force hiding in this investigation?
We have not been hiding anything. The investigations have been made public. The explanations of those where there is a clear explanation have been made public. The hearing this morning was public for just that reason.
None of the evidence that I have examined would indicate any proof at all that we are being visited by extraterrestrials.
Dr. J. Allen Hynek is one of the most important figures in this matter. As a senior government representative, he faithfully continued to dismiss all UFO sightings as swamp gas, mass hallucinations, temperature inversions, and conventional aircraft until Blue Book was terminated in 1969. However, 4 years later, he founded the Center for UFO Studies, which is still active today. In 1985, shortly before his death, he revealed that Project Blue Book had indeed misled the public.
I was there at Blue Book, and I know the job they had. They were told not to excite the public. Don't rock the boat. And I saw it in my own eyes happen that whenever a case happened that they could explain, which is quite a few, they made point of that and let that out to the media. Things that the cases that were very difficult to explain, they would jump handsprings to keep the media away from.
By convening a panel of top scientists to examine the UFO phenomenon, the CIA's concern was that recent waves of sightings might constitute a threat to our national security. The thinking was that the enemy could exploit UFOs as a decoy in the preparation for an attack on the United States. Five outstanding scientists and various Air Force and CIA representatives were to meet on Wednesday, January 14, 1953. Among the panel members was one associate member who was destined to have more experience with the UFO phenomena than any other American scientist to date, Dr. J. Allen Hynek, astrophysicist and head of the astronomy department of Northwestern University.
I was called into the meeting on Thursday. The panel members were seated around this table. It was a rather somber and impressive occasion, actually. I was a junior member, and I remember feeling considerably nervous and apprehensive about being in front of this powerhouse of scientists. But then for the past 4 years, I had been scientific advisor to the U.S. Air Force on this very problem. There were two films that were of particular interest to the panel at that time. One was a film taken by a Navy officer while on vacation in Utah, near Tremonton, Utah. And the other was a film taken in Great Falls, Montana, by the owner of the local baseball team. The Utah film had already been subjected to some 1,000 or so man hours of analysis by the Navy's Photographic Interpretation Laboratory. So the panel got up from their chairs and crouched around the wall to examine the films, and they asked to have the films run several times, as a matter of fact. Now, the Navy had, on the basis of their detailed analysis of the Utah films, they had concluded that the objects shown in the films could not be birds, balloons, aircraft, and so forth, but indeed that they were self-luminous, unidentified objects. Despite this conclusion, the panel rejected it and concluded that the objects were birds. They couldn't be unidentified, therefore they had to be birds. I came away from the meeting and from the room with the distinct feeling, however, that the panel had deliberately moved to debunk the whole subject and not to give it the serious scientific attention which it deserved.
There was a time when people would cite flying saucers, and wherever they made reports, they were sometimes treated or ridiculed or called wackos or crazy people. What Dr. Hynek and his people are trying to do is present a forum where people can present the most unusual sightings and have them treated with dignity and without fear of being ridiculed. Would you please welcome from the Center of UFO Studies in Evanston, Illinois, Dr. J. Allen Hynek. Dr. Hynek. when you first get a report of a sighting, is your job to assemble evidence that will prove it to be so, or to assemble evidence to prove that it did not happen? You know, there are two ways to go on any investigation.
The first thing we do is to try to disprove it.
Mm-hmm.
Because what is the point of establishing, of perpetuating a myth or something that isn't so? And it turns out that some 90% of the raw reports, see, we have a nationwide police network, an 800 number that the police use, and we get reports every night from police departments or different parts of the country. Most of them are planets, twinkling stars,
explainable or identifiable things.
The IFOs, we call them, identifiable flying objects. But that remaining 10%, those are the ones we go after. Now, a UFO, the U in UFO, of course, simply means unidentified. It does not necessarily mean visitors from outer space. But it must be unidentified not just to the person who is puzzled by it, but it must remain unidentified after considerable study. Then and only then is it a UFO.
What are you investigating right now? What have been some things that have come up in the last couple of months that you're looking into?
Well, we have a very interesting case in Muscatine, Iowa, just comes to mind. Sometimes, you know, animals are the first things to give warning that something strange is going on.
Oh, anytime. In California, for example, before an earthquake, the animal kingdom is aware of it long before we are. They do
things. That's true.
Things.
Now, we had a letter from a chap saying that what first called my attention to something going on was the fuss that the horses were raising in the barn. But this time it's rabbits. It's a rather interesting story. There is a chap that runs a toll gate at Muscatine, Iowa, across the river there. And he runs from the 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. shift.
Works the all-night, okay.
Yeah. And about 3 o'clock in the morning, it has been his custom for quite a while to feed the wild rabbits. He takes carrots and tosses them out, and the rabbits grab a carrot and dash off. At this time, at 10 minutes to 3, he goes out there and the rabbits are just lying flat and immobile on the cement, not dead,
okay,
but just as though they were petrified, paralyzed. And simultaneously, as soon as he sees that, he hears a humming sound, loud humming sound, and a large yellow object rises from across the river and comes across, and the whole thing lasted for some 6 minutes. As soon as it was gone, the rabbits jumped back to life and scurried off. And also, at the same time, we're still investigating, there was a concomitant power outage in Muscatine. Now, we don't know whether that had anything to do with the UFO mm-hmm. or not, but it may have.
Usually there is some kind of a power fluctuation or power
outage. So those are the sorts of things that we investigate.
Mm-hmm. All right. And but you have no, the jury's still out on this one.
Jury's still out on that one, yeah.
What do you think the government knows about UFOs that they're not telling us? If you could say it in a sentence or two before I introduce Mr. Gersten here.
Yeah, that's his baby, and the point is that I was with Project Blue Book, of course, for a long while. In fact, it was as an astronomer that I got into this. I think it's always important for me, recognize that I am an astronomer and got into it because the Air Force needed an astronomer. And in fact, I continue to be an astronomer. I'm going to have a monthly column in Science Digest on astronomy, not on UFOs. Now, in my association with Project Blue Book, I know very well that it was not a scientific project. Also, I also know that they never, never would notify the media when an interesting case came up. They did everything they could to
keep it down.
So they definitely withheld information. I will not go so far as to say that it was a Machiavellian sinister cover-up.
Or conspiracy.
Conspiracy. I don't like those terms. But withholding of documents, yes. And that's exactly what Peter Gersten has been so good at getting.
And so diligent in pursuing it through the Freedom of Information Act. Well,
yeah.
Let me do a station break here, and we'll bring Mr. Gersten out, and we'll have a little go at this.
Good.
You know, when I first interviewed Alan years ago, there was a theory going around that anybody who saw a flying saucer was probably befuddled by swamp gas somewhere in Louisiana and didn't know what he or she was seeing. We've had a lot of documentation since that time.
I think that one of the main things that has come out here that Peter has done is to substantiate the credibility of many of the civilians, because it was easy to, and still is, to discredit a civilian. Much more difficult to discredit a military man. In Blue Book, for instance, we would get reports from military pilots, and that was particularly embarrassing to the Air Force, because after they had trained those men, and they couldn't very well, they could say that a civilian pilot might have been untrustworthy, but they could hardly say that to their, of their own military
exactly.
pilots. And we got case after case after case from military pilots, which never hit the press.
Remember about 10 years ago, maybe even longer, there were reports of sightings in the daily press on an almost weekly basis. There'd be an account on page 3 or 4 of most major newspapers that somebody somewhere in this country had sighted a flying saucer. Oftentimes there'd be a photograph of the sky with an object or something. You don't see much of that in newspapers anymore. Are there no sightings, or is the press not reporting them? Do they consider it not to be newsworthy?
That's it. To a large extent, it's no longer news because the same sorts of things are being reported. See, if it was something new, there are three things about this whole thing, Tom, that no one can deny. They're incontrovertible points. Even the grossest skeptic can't deny them. The first of all is that the UFO reports not only exist but persist. See, when I started with the Air Force, I thought that this was a fad, and a few years would just disappear.
Be all over, okay.
And it's global. We have reports now from 140 countries. I mean, practically as many countries as there are in the United Nations. And the most important of the three things is that many, unfortunately not all, but many of the reports come from highly, highly credible, technically trained people, you see.
What do the Russians say about flying saucers? Do they have anything like this going on?
Alan is the expert in that area.
Here we have a report issued under the sponsorship of the...
Let me do the commercial and then we'll...
The Russians.
We're talking about whether the Russians have a policy on UFOs or flying saucers, as we call them.
Very recently, everything you read in Pravda said that flying saucers were propaganda from the decadent Western societies. But recently, the Russian Academy of Sciences has released a report called The Observations of Anomalous Atmospheric Phenomena in the USSR. It doesn't sound like it's UFO, but they say in the introduction, we use the term anomalous atmospheric phenomenon because we consider the previously used term UFO to be less adequate for such work, since it contains a definite interpretation of the phenomenon. You see, there's the point. In the public mind, UFO is synonymous with little green men from outer space.
Mm-hmm.
That's putting the cart before the horse. What we are studying at the Center for UFO Studies in Evanston are the properties of a phenomenon. Here is this constant flow of reports whose contents are bizarre and tremendously intriguing. That's what we're studying. And the center is basically a collection of a rather loose association of scientists from various universities who have become intrigued by this intellectually challenging thing. It's particularly heartening to me to see the rise of interest among scientists and particularly astronomers. In the UFO problem. So it has often been said that why don't astronomers see UFOs? As a matter of fact, they do. In a very recent report by Professor Sturrock of Stanford University, who queried all the members of the American Astronomical Society, found that 53% of those who responded said that, in their opinion, the UFO problem was worthy of scientific study. And what is more, 64 of the astronomers who responded gave what would be called UFO reports, objects, sightings that they personally had made at their observatories frequently, which to them was unexplained.
Dr. Hynek was officially researching UFOs for the U.S. Air Force and compiling a classified report known as Project Sign, later to become known as Project Blue Book.
Well, it was as an astronomer that I first became associated with the UFO problem. In 1948, the Air Force asked me, as an astronomer, to assist them in seeing how many of the reports on flying saucers that were coming in at that time could be explained astronomically. And one thing led to another, and I became scientific consultant to the Air Force and remained so for some 20 years. I started almost as a complete skeptic, because I thought the whole thing was a question of post-war nerves, but it was the persistence of the phenomenon, it refused to dry up and blow away, that finally led me to the belief that we had a real phenomenon to deal with. This year marks the 30th anniversary of the advent of the flying saucer, and that is a most unfortunate term, in my opinion, because it invites ridicule, it opens the door to a great deal of buffoonery and lampooning. It had a perfectly good history, because when Kenneth Arnold described the motions of the discs that he had seen, he said that it was like skipping a saucer over water,
but some reporter thought that was a very clever term, and flying saucers were born. But it is really too bad, because it has caused a great deal of jokes and so forth. For instance, one common expression is that if you want to see a flying saucer, just goose the waitress. There is a shyness and a reluctance on the part of many witnesses, and understandably so, against reporting, because too many have been ridiculed and life has been made somewhat miserable for them. But at the Center for UFO Studies, both in the States and in Australia, it is our standard practice never to use a person's name without their specific permission.
If, for instance, NASA someday were to investigate a civilization in some other solar system and found that civilization to be several steps below our state at that time, then we would know enough about psychology and sociology to realize that the worst thing we could do would be to just barge in and snow them. It would just either cause panic or worship. What a smart group would do would be to slowly infiltrate, slowly begin to affect the mass mind and get them conditioned to the idea that they might be visited someday. Slowly the mass mind begins to accept the idea that, well, it's not so unusual. Yeah, sure. You know, the way in science things have very frequently gone, the first step is complete disbelief. Then there comes a stage where they say, well, you know, it might be so. Then the third and final stage is, oh, I knew it all the time. And Bernard Shaw said all great ideas, you know, begin as heresies.